welcome back to this series of lectures on concrete engineering and technology. So far, we were on the subject of revising the fundamentals of concrete, and we were talking about constituents, and we had said that, well, normally concrete consists of coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, cement and water, in addition to mineral and chemical admixtures, which are added in certain special cases to obtain desired properties in fresh and hardened concrete. So, out of these, we had completed the discussion on coarse and fine aggregate and ordinary Portland cement. So, in our discussion today, we will focus on the use of mineral and chemical admixtures, which are added to concrete in order to modify or obtain the desired properties in fresh concrete or in hardened concrete. Now, as far as admixtures in concrete are concerned, these are essentially additives to the material, that is concrete, to achieve desired properties, which may be difficult with just the normal constituents of concrete, that is cement, water, coarse aggregate and fine aggregate. Considerations for adding these could be technical, which is basically the issue of properties. We want a certain property in the concrete, which we cannot get, and therefore, we need to add admixtures. It could be economical. Cement may be too expensive to use. Is there a possibility of using something else instead of cement, which is cheaper without compromising the properties of concrete from the point of view of the specifications or what is required? Or there could be environmental concern. There is a certain material that we produce in the industry or somewhere, which if disposed of indiscriminately leads to pollution and so on. If it can be gainfully used in concrete, that is the best thing that can happen. So, there can be an environmental concern which would prompt us to use that material as an admixture in concrete. Now, we will discuss this issue of mineral and chemical admixtures from a very engineering point of view and not get involved with the complex chemistry of using admixtures in concrete. Continuing our discussion, we have been talking of chemical admixtures and mineral admixtures. These are the two broad classifications under which admixtures would qualify. Now, within mineral admixtures, we use materials which replace cement, that is, they are so fine that their fineness is comparable to that of cement, and therefore, we try to treat them as a part of cement in considering concrete. Other than these, there are certain other materials which are used at times replacing fine aggregate, that is sand. Common terminology for mineral admixtures would include only those that replace cement. Of those materials also, which can be used as replacements for fine aggregate, that is sand. Now, coming to the first item, that is chemical admixtures. Chemical admixtures in principle interfere with the action of cement within concrete and including its hydration. Depending on the desired effect, the chemical admixtures chosen could be that they act as set regulators. On account of hydration of cement, the cement sets. There is an initial setting time, there is a final setting time, the process goes on and we get hardening of cement and so on. Now, set regulation means a process by which we either accelerate this process or we delay this process. So, therefore, we could have accelerators or we could have retarders. These are useful when we are using cement or concrete in specific applications. In a repair job where concrete is required to have early strength, we may like to use accelerators. Whereas, in a job where concrete is to be placed at a site which is far away, we may need to use retarders. Another example could be in hot or cold weather concrete. When the temperature is very cold and the cement may not set normally within a reasonable period of time, we may like to use an accelerator. Similarly, if we are working in hot weather, then we may use a retarder, which will give us a little more time to work with the concrete so that it does not set very rapidly on account of the high temperature. Other than set regulators, we will have, or we have, water reducers and high range water reducers. Now, what is the difference between water reducers and high range water reducers? Essentially, these chemical admixtures are those which enable us to reduce the water demand in a concrete mix. So, a water reducer, if it helps us to reduce the demand by say 10 to 15%, a high range water reducer is a chemical which enables us to reduce that water demand by say 25 to 30%. So, it is only a matter of how much water reduction can be achieved by using one chemical or another. Now, how this reduction in water demand is used to an engineering advantage in proportioning concrete mixes or in concrete engineering in general, that we shall see through examples later on in this discussion. Then we have another class of chemical admixtures called air entrainers. We have seen earlier in a slide that concrete contains certain amount of air. Now, entrapped air is that which is there in concrete without any effort, that is, it is inadvertently there. However, in certain cases, we want to entrain air, that is, intentionally and consciously, we want the concrete to have a certain amount of air particles. Now, those chemicals which help us achieve this objective of entraining air in the fresh concrete, which remains there while the concrete hardens, are called air entrainers. There are other chemical admixtures as well, which are very special purpose admixtures, for example, corrosion inhibitors. There is literature which says that if we use chemicals such as nitrites and so on, we get a better performance from the point of view of reinforcement corrosion. The presence of these nitrites interferes or modifies the pore solution in a manner that the reinforcing bars in such a concrete become more resistant to corrosion. The electrochemical process involving corrosion is slowed down, and so on and so forth. So, there are all these classes of different chemical admixtures which are used in the concrete industry in order to modify the properties of concrete. So, let us try to take a look at some of them in greater detail. Chemical admixtures are usually available as liquids and are often batched by volume. Since the dosage is very small, very special care needs to be taken at the time of batching. The pure admixture is often diluted with water and then added as a part of the unit water content required to be mixed to ensure a better distribution in the concrete. So, we do not normally batch a concentrated chemical admixture into concrete. Rather, we dilute it with the mixing water. Part of the mixing water is added with the chemical admixture to the concrete, and then the mixing water is added, the remaining part of it is added, so that the chemical admixture is more homogeneously mixed throughout the concrete mix in the mixer. As far as dosage is concerned, these are relatively small dosages, and since the action of chemical admixtures is related to the amount of cement present in the system, the dosage is often given in terms of cement content. That is, if the dosage is 1% by weight of cement in a concrete, it means that if a concrete contains 400 kgs per cubic meter of cement, only 4 kgs of the admixture per cubic meter of concrete need be added. It should be noted that the weight of a cubic meter of concrete is about 2400 kgs, and therefore, these chemical admixtures constitute a very small percentage of concrete by weight, and therefore, the presence of these chemical admixtures can be ignored as far as the volumetrics of the concrete mix is concerned. They are usually considered along with the volume of water which is present in the concrete mix. Let us consider an example. Let the chemical admixture that we want to use be available in an aqueous solution, say 4 kgs is dissolved in 10 liters of water. Now, if 4 kgs of chemical admixture is required, the example that we saw earlier, that 1% of cement is required and there is 400 kgs of cement in the concrete mix, we need 4 kgs of the chemical admixture. So, in that situation, given that 4 kgs of this chemical admixture is dissolved in 10 liters of water, we can use 10 liters of this concentrate, and we say that 10 liters of concentrate is added and 10 liters of water is adjusted against the total water to be added. If 6 kgs of chemical admixture is required, that is about say 1.5% of that concrete mix, then 15 liters of the concentrate is added and 15 liters of the water adjusted against the total water required. That is, if the original water demand was 180 kgs per cubic meter, then in this case, what we will do is we will use 10 kgs with the chemical admixture and only 170 kgs of water need be added to the concrete mix, and we will have a concrete mix which has 180 kgs of water along will have 180 kgs of water. No doubt 10 of that was used to deliver the 4 kgs of chemical admixture which was required. In this case similarly, if the demand was again 180, we need to use only 165 kgs of water and 15 kgs has already been added as given here. And therefore, this mix 2 contains 180 kgs of water. No doubt 15 kgs of that was used to deliver the 6 kgs of chemical admixture required. Now, let us come to set regulators. They are used under special conditions as I mentioned earlier. When concrete is used in hot or cold temperatures, there could be a need to regulate the setting process either to accelerate it or to retard it. A retarder could also be used to prevent formation of a cold joint or a construction joint. An accelerator could be used in cases when high early strength is required. Let us look at schematically what happens when we use a retarding or a setting agent. Let us say that this is the normal slump loss. That is, if we have an original slump value, as the hydration process continues, the concrete continues to lose its slump, it continues to become stiffer. And this is the process, the black line here is the process for normal concrete, that is a concrete which does not have any chemical admixture added to it. Now, if I retard this, that is we have a retarder in an appropriate dosage within the concrete mix, what will happen is that initially there will be no slump loss, that is the slump loss will be very small. Gradually, of course, as the hydration process overtakes any kind of a retarding action that is there, there will be slump loss, and finally, we will come to a situation where there is no slump and we do not require any slump at that point in time. Similarly, if we want to accelerate the process, we want the concrete to harden earlier, then we use an accelerator and we use or we get rapid slump loss if we are using a accelerator in the beginning. Now, what this picture shows is that depending on our need, depending on the requirements of the job, we may need to specify not only what is the initial slump of the concrete that is measured at the concrete plant, but we may also need to specify the slump at a certain point in time, that after the mixing has been done, we want a concrete which is almost having the same slump or having almost the same slump as that at plant, or we do not want the concrete to have any slump, we want the concrete to have reasonably set, or the hydration process to have reasonably progressed. So, this is the importance of having, so that is the importance of understanding the action of retarders and accelerators in terms of how they alter the properties of fresh concrete, in this case slump, which is measured or monitored in terms of slump loss. Now, water reducing agents or high range water reducing agents, they are used to reduce the water demand for a given slump. That is, slump and water demand are linearly related. The more water we add to the concrete mix, the higher slump we get. Now, in order to get the same slump, if there was another method other than increasing water, that is precisely the water reduction or the water reducers, and their effectiveness, that is the effectiveness of a water reducer, can be measured in terms of the percentage of water reduction that can be achieved for a given dosage. So, if there is an admixture with 1% can cause or can bring about a reduction in water demand to say 5%, and there is another admixture, let us say B, which at the same dosage of 1% of cement gives me a water reduction of 15%, then B is more effective as a water reducer than A. What we are really saying, if 180 kgs of water is required for a certain slump without an admixture in a normal concrete, and we use an admixture with a certain dosage which can reduce water demand by 20%, then we get the same slump at 180 minus 36, because 36 is 20% of 180 at 154 kgs. That is, concretes say A made with only 180 kgs of water and a concrete B made with 154 kgs of water and a certain percentage of the chemical admixture, which gives us 20% reduction in the water demand, will have the same slump. This understanding is very important when we are working with water reducers and high range water reducers. There are two ways of looking at it. One is to say that, okay, 1% or a certain dosage of a chemical admixture gives me 5% or 10% reduction in water demand. The other side of the coin is that if we want 15% water reduction, what should be the dosage? So, with this, and this is the discussion that goes on when we do proportioning of concrete mixes using water reducers or high range water reducers. Now, let us see how a water reducing agent can be actually used in concrete engineering for different purposes. Let us consider a concrete mix where we will basically be talking only of the water content, the cement content. These two are given in terms of kgs per cubic meter, water cement ratio, which is a percentage, the chemical admixture, which is given as a 0 or a 1, that is the either it is present or it is not present. Let us say the slump, which is given in centimeters, strength, which is given in MPa. We further assume that water and slump are directly related, and similarly, water cement ratio and strength are directly related. So, if we increase the water content, we increase the slump. We reduce the water cement ratio, we increase the strength. So, with this fundamental understanding, let us say that we have a base mix which has 180 kgs of unit water content, 360 kgs of cement, which gives us a water cement ratio of 0.5. We do not use a chemical admixture to begin with, because it is the base mix, and this base mix has a slump of 8 centimeters and a strength of 32 MPa at a certain H. Now, mix 2, where a certain amount of chemical admixture has been added, and we are able to reduce the water demand to 160 kgs. Now, what are the implications? If we do not change the cement content, we keep it the same, 360 kgs, what have we effectively done? We have brought down the water cement ratio from 0.5 to 0.44. Now, given our understanding that 180 kgs of water or 160 kgs of water plus chemical admixture will have the same slump, the slump remains the same. However, since we have reduced the water cement ratio, the strength will increase. So, what have we effectively achieved? We have achieved higher strength in the concrete mix. So, this is one way of using a water reducer. So, we have used a water reducer, we have reduced the water content, and effectively what we have achieved, however, is the increase in the compressive strength of the concrete. Consider another example. Here, when we reduced the water content, or where we could reduce the water content to 160, we did not want the strength to go up. We were happy with the strength of 32 MPa. So, we let, in order that this 32 MPa strength be preserved, or we do, since we did not want higher strength, what we need to do is to keep the water cement ratio at the same level of 0.5, and that can be done if we keep the cement level at 320, because our water cement ratio is 0.5 and the water content in this mix is 160. So, what have we effectively achieved? Cement saving. Instead of using 360 kgs of cement, we are now able to get the same 32 MPa strength with just 320 kgs of cement. Of course, like in the previous example, the slump is the same, 8 centimeters, because we are still working with 160 kgs of the water and a certain amount of chemical admixture. Now, the third form of using a water reducer would be where we do not reduce the water content. We keep it at 180, and yet we use the chemical admixture at a certain dosage. We do not alter the cement content either. It is still retained at 360 kgs. What is the characteristics of this mix? The water cement ratio is 0.5, and therefore, the strength will still be 32 MPa. What will happen to the slump? A slump value which was there at a level of 8 centimeters, when we were using 160 kgs with the chemical admixture, will go up, because now instead of 160, we are using 180 kgs of water. 160 kgs plus chemical admixture was giving me, say, 8 centimeters of slump. Now, if I push my water content up to 180, the slump will go up. So, effectively what I have achieved is plasticizing action. That is, the concrete has become more workable. So, depending on how we use, whether we choose to save cement, whether we choose to increase the strength, or we choose to plasticize the concrete mix, all these three actions are possible when we are using a water reducer or a high range water reducer or a super plasticizer. Of course, I must caution that this is a very, very simplified picture, a simplistic picture as a matter of fact, where an assertion is made that the slump is depending only on the water content. It is independent of the cement content, which it really is not, but it is an illustrative example to show how the use of water reducers can be an effective way to adjust, modify, or engineer the properties of concrete, whether it is the fresh concrete in terms of slump or it is the hardened concrete in terms of strength. Now, let us come to air entraining admixtures. These are used in air entrant concrete. We sometimes call concrete as AE concrete and non-AE concrete. Now, AE concrete is air entrant concrete, that is that concrete where an admixture has been added to consciously entrain air into the system, whereas a non-air entrant concrete is one where air may be still present, but it is the entrapped air and not entrained air, and it is there only unintentionally and not entrained. Air entrainment is accompanied by an increase in workability, and hence it may be required that the unit water content may have to be reduced for a certain workability. What happens is that when we entrain air in fresh concrete, air gets entrained in the form of minute bubbles. Now, these bubbles act as ball bearings and improve the workability of concrete. And therefore, once we are using air entrainment for some purpose, we may need to reduce the water content of the concrete mix in order to preserve the workability. So, that is something which we must keep at the back of our mind when proportioning concretes with air entrainers. Air entrained concrete is recommended for use in environments with cyclic freezing and thawing. We have mentioned earlier that cyclic freezing and thawing means concrete structures built in environments where the temperatures vary over the year in a range that causes the concrete or the water in concrete to freeze and thaw. And once the concrete the water in concrete freezes and thaws, that causes distress to the pore structure, and it has been found that having air entrained concrete in such environments is one of the options that an engineer can use to increase the durability. This is what is being said, that if the air content in concrete is in the range of 1, 1.5, 2 to 3%, then what is called the durability factor, that is how durable the concrete is in the freezing and thawing environment, the durability factor is very small. However, if the concrete is in the range having 4 to 6% of air, then the durability factor is very, very high. And that is what is being said when we state that in the case where concrete is exposed to cyclic freezing and thawing, having a certain amount of entrained air is a very good idea to increase the durability of the concrete. These pictures here show the presence of air voids within the hardened concrete matrix. Please remember that the blue color or the red color and so on are always just illustrative, and the air in the concrete does not have any specific color. Apart from all these admixtures, set regulators, water reducers and air entrainers, there are other chemical admixtures which we talked about, and these are also added to concrete at the time of mixing for other action such as corrosion inhibitors like nitrites. And there is evidence that the presence of these ions in the concrete matrix helps in preventing or providing additional resistance against reinforcement corrosion in reinforced concrete. Now, before we close the discussion on chemical admixtures, I would like to point out that the effectiveness or the dosage of a chemical admixture is related to the properties of cement. Finer cements, coarser cements, cements with higher C3A or a higher C3S and so on, they will need to be handled differently when we are trying to adjust the dosage of a chemical admixture for any purpose, whether it is set regulation or it is water reduction or it is air entrainment and so on. So, one has to be very careful when using chemical admixtures in terms of determining the compatibility of the chemical admixtures with the cement which is used. It is a good practice that whenever the lot of cement changes or the batch of the chemical admixtures changes, then simple tests should be carried out in the laboratory to ensure that the compatibility still exists and a minor adjustment in the dosage of the chemical admixture is appropriately made. Let's continue the discussion on admixtures in concrete. Having completed chemical admixtures, let's now come to mineral admixtures, especially in the role of replacing cement. Now, the motivation for using mineral admixtures in a concrete could come from one or more of the following: industrial byproduct utilization. We have the steel industry or the thermal power plants, which are classically cited as examples where we get large amounts of blast furnace slag or fly ash, which are used in concrete as mineral admixtures. We have the copper industry, which gives copper slag, which again is a potential candidate for use in concrete as a mineral admixture, and so on. So, there is this issue of industrial byproduct utilization in concrete. There is environmental concern in terms of sustainable development, which is related to industrial byproduct utilization, where we want that certain products from the industry or byproducts, waste from the industry, which can be gainfully used in the concrete. Then we have the issue of economy in cement consumption. Cement is the most expensive of the concrete constituents, and even if we are able to save a kg of cement in a cubic meter, that translates into a lot of savings as far as the project, as far as the carbon footprint and so on is concerned. The reduced heat of hydration. Using cement is not only uneconomical, but it also gives us large amount of heat of hydration, which in certain cases becomes an issue in case of mass concrete and so on, and therefore, we may like to reduce the cement consumption in concrete, not only from the point of view of economy, but also from the point of view of handling or controlling the heat of hydration. Durability issues. Certain times, if we use fly ash or we use blast furnace slag or silica fume, we enhance the durability of the concrete structure, because the pore structure of the concrete containing these admixtures is finer. The concrete is less permeable and therefore more durable. So, durability concerns or considerations often drive us to use mineral admixtures along with cement in a concrete mix. There may be strength requirements. At times, it may be not possible to achieve a certain strength or a certain level of strength by using only the traditional ordinary Portland cement, at least in an economical manner or in a manner that the concrete still continues to satisfy the specifications in terms of heat of hydration or the maximum temperature and so on. And therefore, for even strength considerations, we may need to use mineral admixtures. Now, they are used in concrete usually as a partial replacement of cement, or they are used in addition to the cement. Now, this is done in order to improve the properties of concrete, obviously, and can be in terms of compressive strength, liberation of heat of hydration, or any other parameter that we choose to identify, specify, and monitor. Historically, the use of pozzolanic material is very well known, and these materials have no hydraulic properties of their own, and they do not simply harden by adding water. Rather, they react with calcium hydroxide and yield products similar to those formed during cement hydration. So, what these mineral admixtures do, they do not react with water that is added to the concrete. However, the water and the cement, when they react, they form large amounts of calcium hydroxide. And this calcium hydroxide is what the mineral admixtures react with to give hydration products, or products of that reaction are similar to the products formed on account of normal cement hydration. In recent years, the following have emerged as the primary mineral admixtures used in concrete as far as replacement of cement is concerned: ground granulated blast furnace slag, fly ash, and silica fume. Please note that this is not all kinds of ash that we get from the thermal power plants. The thermal power plants produce primarily two kinds of ash. One is pond ash and the other is fly ash. Pond ash does not find too much of use in concrete, even though there is effort being made to use pond ash as well, at least as a concrete material or as a constituent of concrete, even if not considering it as a part of cement. But fly ash is the one that has found widespread use as far as a mineral admixture is concerned, and then there is silica fume, of course. Other materials such as metakaolin or rice husk ash may also be used as mineral admixtures, provided they satisfy whatever is the requirement that a client or a code may choose to impose on the use of mineral admixtures in concrete. Now, as far as the dosage of these mineral admixtures is concerned, it obviously depends on the efficiency of the mineral admixture. Now, what is the efficiency of a mineral admixture? It basically is the ability of the admixture or that material to replace cement. If to replace a kg of cement we require more material, then the efficiency is lower. If lesser amount of material can be used to replace a kg of cement, it is more efficient. The dosage of the mineral admixture obviously depends on the efficiency of the mineral admixture. Now, what is efficiency of a mineral admixture? It is the ability of a mineral admixture to replace cement. If there are two mineral admixtures A and B, such that in order to replace a kg of cement, less of A is required, then A is more efficient as a mineral admixture than B. Of course, the second part of it is the desired result. What do we expect from the concrete? And that will determine what the dosage of the mineral admixture is, or how much of that mineral admixture is required to be used in a cubic meter of concrete. The following is a general range in which the mineral admixtures are added to concrete as far as fly ash, slag and silica fume are concerned. Now, slag is used to the extent of 30% to 70% by weight of cement under replacement. Similarly, fly ash is used up to 10% to 30% by weight of cement, again as replacement, and silica fume is usually added in the range of 5% to 15% by weight of cement in the mode of addition. Now, let me just give an example of what replacement and addition means. If we consider a base concrete mix which has say 350 kgs of cement per cubic meter, without any mineral admixture. Now, if there is a mix 2 where we have 300 kgs of cement and 80 kgs of the mineral admixture, what has happened effectively is that 50 kgs of cement has been replaced by 80 kgs of the mineral admixture. In another case, if we use the same amount of cement, that is 350 kgs, but we use 80 kgs of mineral admixture in addition to the 350 kgs of cement, then this concrete mix has a mineral admixture in addition to the cement content, or in addition to the cement. Whereas, in this case, the mineral admixture is in partial replacement of cement. So, if we have an example like this, where 80 kgs of mineral admixture has replaced 50 kgs of cement, then we can try to define the efficiency of one admixture versus another admixture. As stated in the previous slides, fly ash and slag are typically used in replacement or partial replacement of cement, whereas silica fume is often used in addition to the cement that is there in the concrete mix. Another example that is given here is a 50% replacement by slag in a concrete mix containing 400 kgs of cubic meter of cement will thus mean that the mix now has 200 kgs of cement and 200 kgs of slag. Similarly, use of 5% additional silica in a similar mix would mean that the mix contains 20 kgs per cubic meter of silica fume in addition to the 400 kgs of cement per cubic meter of that concrete. Of course, we have to keep in mind that what is the property that is going to change. For example, in this case, if the replacement given here is a 1-to-1 replacement, that is 200 kgs of cement has been replaced by 200 kgs of slag without any change in the properties of concrete, whether it is fresh concrete or hardened concrete, then the efficiency of the slag is 1. That is, it has replaced unit to unit, kg to kg of the cement. It may not usually happen. We may need to use a little more of the mineral admixture, whether it is slag or it is fly ash or whatever it is, to replace a kg of cement. And that is what we will see later is the idea of the efficiency of a mineral admixture. Of course, when I say that 5 to 15% of silica fume can be used, or 10 to 30% of fly ash can be used, or 30 to 70% of slag can be used, that is just the normal figures. Specialist literature also suggests usage of mineral admixtures beyond these ranges. For example, there is a lot of published material on high volume fly ash in applications such as roads, where the replacement levels for fly ash in concrete is much higher and has been actually used. But these are some things which we will not talk about in this discussion in our. But those applications which are specialized in nature are not within the purview of our discussion in this set of lectures. Now, coming to the efficiency once again, depending on the chemical composition of the mineral admixture, its reactivity with calcium hydroxide will be different, and thus the potential to form the required calcium silicate hydrate gel would vary. See, how does a mineral admixture work? The mineral admixture works through reacting with calcium hydroxide, and if the mineral admixture is such that it is able to react very effectively with calcium hydroxide, produce the same amount of calcium silicate hydrates or hydration products, then it is a very efficient mineral admixture. Whereas in certain cases, for chemical composition, for any other reason, the mineral admixture may not be a very effective admixture, and therefore its efficiency will be lower. The efficiency of a mineral admixture may therefore be defined in terms of its ability to replace cement in a concrete mix. For, as I have said earlier, that if 200 kgs of an admixture is required to achieve the strength, and in this example we are using strength as the parameter, to achieve the strength obtained by 100 kgs of cement, then its efficiency is 50%, because 100 kg of cement has been replaced by 200 kgs of mineral admixture, or 200 kgs of the mineral admixture were required to be used in order to get the same output which we were getting with 100 kgs of cement, and therefore the efficiency of that mineral admixture is 50%. In other words, if we are given the mineral admixture's efficiency, then we know how much of that mineral admixture we should be using in a concrete mix in order that the quality of concrete or the desired parameter that we have, that is not compromised by using the mineral admixture. In other words, the strength of the following two concrete mixes should be the same: 350 kg per cubic meter of cement, or 300 kgs of cement with 100 kgs of mineral admixture having an efficiency of 50%. These two will produce identical strengths if we have strength as the parameter and we know that the mineral admixture that we are using has an efficiency of 50%. In another example, when we had talked about 50 kgs of cement being replaced by 80 kgs of the mineral admixture, there the efficiency can be taken to be 50/80, which is 62%. Another implication of using mineral admixtures in concrete is the increase in the powder content of concrete. This, of course, assumes that the efficiency of the mineral admixture is less than 100%, and therefore, to replace any amount of cement, more of the mineral admixture is required. This causes an increase in the paste or the mortar content of the concrete. If, for example, the specific gravity of cement and the mineral admixture are known to be 3.12 and 2.2, and the efficiency of the mineral admixture is known to be 60%. Then, if we have a concrete mix here, which has water content of 175, a water cement ratio of 50%, and therefore, you use 350 kgs of cement. So, in another mix, if we want to get to the same level, we will need 175 kgs of water with 300 kgs of cement, but 80 kgs of mineral admixtures instead of the 50 kgs. Now, this 50 kgs of cement is being replaced by 80 kgs of the mineral admixture. Now, since the mineral admixture is lighter than the cement, then the volume is more. The volume is any case more, because 50 kgs is becoming 80 kgs on account of the efficiency. And then the volume is further increasing because the densities are lower. So, what is effectively happening is that if we do a calculation, we will find that the powder content in the concrete mix is 112 liters in the first case, and in the second case it has gone to 132 liters. The paste content, therefore, which is the sum of the powder content, that is water and the powder, is 287.18 in one case, and in the other case it is 307.52. So, we have added more powder, and therefore, we have caused the paste content to increase. Now, let us go back to a very old slide, which we saw in the first lecture, where we had defined cement and water to be paste and sand to be mortar, and mortar and coarse aggregate to be concrete. And we had asked a question as to what is the need to change or reiterate those definitions in the context of modern day concrete engineering. And now we have the answer that it is not only the cement content which constitutes or provides the powder as far as a concrete mix is concerned. In addition to cement, there could be mineral admixtures, whether they take part in the hydration reaction or not. Those powders, they definitely would constitute or play a role similar to that of cement paste as far as the properties of fresh concrete are concerned. And therefore, we need to keep this in back, and we must keep this aspect at the back of our mind when we analyze modern concrete mixes or we design modern concrete mixes for specific applications. An illustrative example is already shown here. We have seen this picture before, and we talk in terms of a self-consolidating concrete. It depends on these fines, whether they are part of the fine aggregate, or they could be part of the cement, or they could be in addition to the cement. So, basically the paste content is getting added. So, we have seen this slide earlier, which is a pictorial representation of the volumetrics of a normal mix or a regular concrete mix and a special purpose concrete mix. The role of these fines is what has to be understood in terms of the properties of the fresh concrete. These fines can be considered a part of the fine aggregate, depending on what the nature of the fines is, or as far as mineral admixtures are concerned, they could be considered a part of cement plus mineral admixtures is what constitutes the paste content, which is this much. So, instead of 25% paste in the normal conditions, the amount of paste could go slightly higher, as we have seen, for example, in this case, instead of 287 liters per cubic meter, which is about 28%, it goes to about 30% or 32%. So, this change of 2%, 3% is not insignificant and must be kept in mind when we are designing concrete mixes. Now, let us come to the basic mechanism of mineral admixture action. Normally, tricalcium silicate and the dicalcium silicates, they react with water to form CSH, which is the calcium silicate hydrate, which is the normal or the most common hydration product, and a lot of calcium hydroxide. These two are the direct products of the hydration reaction. And you have seen earlier that the tricalcium silicate and the dicalcium silicates are the bulk of the ordinary Portland cement, and therefore, these are the most common and most voluminous kind of reaction products. As far as the classic pozzolanic reaction is concerned, the silica, which is SiO2, reacts with the calcium hydroxide and forms the same CSH, that is the calcium silicate hydrate, and we get the mineral admixtures reacting with the calcium hydroxide to form the CSH, even though the silica itself is not hydraulic, it does not react with the water and needs the calcium hydroxide to form the binding CSH. In other words, the CSH formed in pozzolanic reactions is really a two-phase reaction. In the first phase, we have the formation of calcium hydroxide from the hydration of cement, and in the second phase, we have the formation of CSH from this calcium hydroxide and the silica. It thus stands to reason to assert that in such cases, the hydration products could be richer in the CSH phase and poorer in the amount of calcium hydroxide finally remaining, because part of this calcium hydroxide has been used in the pozzolanic reaction. So, whereas we have more CSH sitting in the concrete mix, we might have lesser amount of calcium hydroxide, and this has some implications in concrete engineering in certain applications, as the literature suggests. Now, how are mineral admixtures added to the concrete mix? There are basically two options that we have. One is during the manufacture of the cement, and that happens at the cement plant, and there, and what do we get? Blended cements. That is, this mineral admixture is added to the cement at the cement plant, and the cement is not OPC. What the product of the cement plant now is not ordinary Portland cement, it is blended cement, because the mineral admixture has already been added to the OPC. The other option, of course, is to add the mineral admixture during the mixing of the concrete at the concrete plant or at the site of mixing. In this case, the cement used is OPC, and the mineral admixture is added in an appropriate dosage in the plant. So, in this case, the cement manufacturer takes responsibility for the addition of mineral admixtures and ensures and assures the user that the blended cement meets certain specifications and so on, and very often the amount, or the exact amount at least, of the mineral admixture used is not known. What we know is the performance of the blended cement, that yes, it has a certain initial setting time, a certain final setting time, it has certain strength development characteristics, though it is not OPC alone, it is a pozzolanic or a blended cement. In the latter case, where the mineral admixture is added to the concrete at the batching plant or the concrete manufacturer takes responsibility to make sure that the concrete produced has the required properties in terms of strength, workability and so on, and must use only the right amount of mineral admixtures. We will talk about some of these concepts once again when we are proportioning special concrete mixes at another time. With this, we come to an end of the discussion today, where we have talked about chemical admixtures added to concrete and the mineral admixtures added to concrete, also alluded to the manufacture of blended cements, where the mineral admixtures are added to the cement at the time of cement manufacture at the cement plant. Now, before we close, as usual, we will have some questions. How do the properties of cement affect the effectiveness of chemical admixtures? I'd like you to make a list of the other chemical admixtures. That is, we talked about just one, that is the corrosion inhibitors. There are several others, and if you see the literature, you will find other chemical admixtures which are used, which have reported history, where these admixtures have been used for special purposes in concrete construction. I'd like you to prepare a note on how the chemical admixtures actually act. We did not get involved with the mechanism of action of either the set regulator or the water reducer or the air entrainer, but it's an interesting area which you would like to see, and see how cement chemists actually work, or how chemistry and cement technology comes together in this very interesting area. I'd like you to make a list of commercially available chemical admixtures in a region. There are different chemical admixtures, there are different chemicals which are used as chemical admixtures in different parts of the world, and that will be an education for anybody who tries to understand this a little more. I would like you to identify some major concrete construction projects in the world where chemical and mineral admixtures have been used, and I would like you to critically comment on the suggested pozzolanic reaction and the definition of the efficiency of mineral admixtures that we have talked about. Specifically, please try to see how this reaction is different in the case of blast furnace slag or silica fume or fly ash in terms of their reaction with calcium hydroxide, and what is the definition of efficiency which is given. We defined efficiency in terms of the effectiveness of a mineral admixture to replace the cement. How does it work for the different mineral admixtures? And with that, we come to a close of the discussion today. Thank you.